A'udhu billahi min ash-shaytan ar-rajim, bismillahi ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen, wa salatu wa salamu ala sayyidina wa nabiyyina wa tabibi nufusina wa habibi qulubina, abil qasim Muhammad. Sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam la siyama baqiyat Allah ruhi wa arwahu al-alamina li turabi maqdamihi al-fida. My very dear brothers and sisters in Islam and in Iman, assalamu alaykum jami'an wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. We are living the days and the nights of the martyrdom anniversary of Amirul Mu'mineen Ya'subuddin Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi afdalu salawati wa tahiyyat. And therefore, on this occasion, allow me to, on behalf of yourselves and my humbleness, convey our commiseration and condolences to our present Imam, Imam al-Hujjah al-Jalallah Farajahu Sharif, whose heart, both for this sad occasion and what is happening in today's world to a part of the holy body of the Imam, his heart is broken, as I will inshallah speak about it. The month of Ramadan is also the month in which the Holy Quran is revealed. So the question that I want to pose to your respectful brothers and sisters and myself is that so far in this holy month of Ramadan, how have we been dealing with the Quran? Are we only among those whose endeavor and effort and aim and intention has been to just recite the Quran from cover to cover and be content with that? That is just like we are in a race of finishing the Quran and I've done my job and that's all about it, and therefore I was with the Quran in the month of Ramadan? Or besides this, I also have been among those who've been pondering and reflecting among the ayat of the Quran and upon the ayat of the Quran. Or even more than that, by the blessing of God, I've been among those who has been reading the Quran, even one single ayah of the Quran, and by the grace of God, I acted upon that. We all know that eventually the main purpose of the revelation of the Quran is to learn for the purpose of practicing it. There is one ayah in chapter 9 of the Holy Quran, Surah At-Tawbah, ayah 103, that mufassirin and historians tell us that this ayah is revealed in the holy month of Ramadan, second year after the migration of the Holy Prophet. Especially because this is an ayah revealed to the Prophet in the month of Ramadan, and we are in the month of Ramadan, and it's so related to what, inshallah, I want to talk briefly tonight to you. I will recite the ayah. Please look at the screen and bless your mouth. On the breath, you can repeat it with me until, inshallah, I give a short explanation about it. A'udhu billahi min ash-shaytan ar-rajim. Khudh min amwalihim sadaqatan tutahhiruhum wa tuzakkihim biha wa salli alayhim inna salataka sakanun lahum. Wallahu sami'un alim. Sadaqallahu al-Aliyyu al-Azim. As I said, this ayah is in Surah At-Tawbah, ayah 103, and was revealed to the Holy Prophet second year after his migration to Medina, in the same year that the Battle of Badr took place. And there is a correlation between these two. First, let's have a look at quick meaning of the ayah. Khudh min amwalihim. The ayah, the Almighty God is commanding the Prophet. There's an obligation on the Prophet, which makes it an obligation upon Muslims. Take min amwalihim, a portion of their wealth. Not all of it, a portion of it. And in fact, a small portion of it. With what intention we have to give it to the Prophet, and whoever is taking the position of the Prophet in the sense of leading the community, the just rulers and leaders. Min amwalihim sadaqah. Sadaqah here means zakat in a general sense of it. But the expression of sadaqah is to make sure that we give the intention for the sake of God. We give it with the right intention, with sadaq and sincerity. Sadaqatan, what's the purpose of that? Immediately the Almighty God tells us about the benefit that first and foremost comes to me before any benefit goes to anyone else. Tutahhiruhum wa tuzakkihim biha. Tutahhiruhum, tadhir, it means purification. So by giving this charity, by giving this donation, by giving this zakat, the Almighty God says that you, my messenger, and it's important that the purifier and the muzaki also, as I will mention, is the Holy Prophet of Islam. By giving this charity, the Prophet of Islam will purify us. Purification from what? Variety of sins that I'm suffering from, that are stopping me from my spiritual growth. Like what? Especially sins related to my social responsibilities, such as the sin of carelessness, such as the sin of selfishness, such as the sin of me, myself, and my family are the only one that matters for me. I don't care about the rest of the world. These are sins in Islam. And by giving charity, by sharing part of a portion of your wealth with those disadvantaged people, you let the Prophet purify you. وَيُزَكِّيهِمْ وَتُزَكِّيهِمْ بِهَا. This تُزَكِّيهِمْ from the root of zakat, as I've always said, is zakat in a very literal sense. It means when you are in your backyard trimming the trees in your backyard. Once you are cutting the extra branches and the leaves of your tree, you let your tree flourish and grow better. Likewise, by cutting extra money that the Almighty God has entrusted me with, not all what we earn is for ourselves and to be spent on ourselves. Part of it, a portion of it, as clearly this ayah and many other ayat of the Quran, they say, I'm entrusted with to hand it over to the needy people. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is using me as a means to deliver their haqq. وَفِي أَمْوَالِهِمْ حَقٌّ لِلسَّائِلِ وَالْمَحْرُومِ. It's their haqq. It's their right. It belongs to them. I'm only entrusted with for my own growth, spiritual growth, to see how trustworthy I am. And therefore, Quran says that you do your duty, what we have given you, a portion of it, give it to certain people that we have recommended you, oblige you to give, this will spiritually make you grow. And the muzaki, as I said, is the Holy Prophet of Islam. That makes it very significant, this ayah. Then the Almighty God is telling the Prophet, also you pray for them. When you pray for them, your prayer provides serenity, security in them. They feel good and better. We all feel better when we see that. Even you see that you do a charity and the needy people, how they really pray for you, how good it feels internally inside us. This is the reward of it. Okay? Now, the question is that this is one ayah of the Quran. And I want to become a person of Qur'ani in the month of Ramadan, at least in the remaining days and the nights of the month of Ramadan. Is there any application for this ayah? What is the God's expectation on me when it comes to this ayah? Comes to my current situation. Before I take you to the application or one of the major applications of this ayah, let me just make a quick detour and tell you that there is a well-established principle in Islam, that principle is expressed by our Imam Sadiq alayhi salam, that the Imam says that it is just not enough for you and I to assume that I pray, I fast, and therefore I'm Muslim. Or just because I'm born Muslim, yes brother, alhamdulillah, Muslim. Oh my mu'min, believer, there's much more into that. The Imam says, la wallah. He's taking an oath in the majesty name of God. La wallah, la yakunul mu'min wa mu'minan. Impossible in the real sense of it. None of us are real believers. Hatta yakuna li akhihi mithla al jasad. Until we, for one another, we are like one body. Idha daraba alayhi irqun wahid, tada'at lahu sa'iru uruqih. If one vein is cut, the rest of the veins of the body are unrest, are not comfortable. They are disturbed as well. It's just like once you get a headache, your whole body is uncomfortable. You get a toothache, the whole body is unrest. We are supposed to be like this, irrespective of our nationality background, whether we speak the same language or not, whether we share the same, citizenship passport or not. So far as we are believers, especially as the lovers and the followers of Ahlul Bayt alayhimus salam, no matter where in the world we live, if we hear that a Shia, a believer, a lover of Ahlul Bayt alayhimus salam, somewhere in the world is affected, and I feel that it's just like something has happened to my close family members or to myself. Then, and I do something about it, then I'm inshallah a believer, according to the very words of Imam Sadiq alayhi salam. Otherwise, those who give a cold shoulder and say that, well, none of our business, they cannot be really a believer. Now, going back to the history, at the time of Imam Ali alayhi salam, in the city of Al-Anbar, that today is a province, all right, Imam Ali alayhi salam hears that a group of rebels and insurgents, subhanallah, exactly the history repeats itself. They are known in the history as Al-Ghasitin, and the Imam refers in fact to them as Ghasitin. Al-Ghasit is unjust person, unlike Muqsit, which means Al-Adil. Asit means unjust, because they stood up against the legitimate government of Imam Ali alayhi salam. They were rebels, insurgents. The Imam heard the sad news that the insurgents, the rebels, they invaded part of his territory and went to one of the villages in Al-Anbar, and they charged into a Christian's house, looted the jewelry of a Christian lady, and then went to the house of a Muslim person, looted the jewelry of a Muslim lady. In his famous sermon, Imam Ali alayhi salam says that فَوَاللَّهُ لَوْ أَنَّ امْرَأً مُسْلِمًا مَاتَ مِنْ هَذَا أَسَفًا مَا كَانَ عِنْدِي مَلُومًا بَلْ كَانَ بِهِ جَدِيرًا. By Allah, if someone of the agony of this news, that even the houses of some of my subjects, citizens in an Islamic territory has been looted, if somebody dies of the agony of this news, not only I don't blame him, I admire him. Subhanallah, see how the history repeats itself. Brothers and sisters, Imam Ali alayhi salam, for whom we cry and commemorate tonight and these nights, look at what he says. Only when he hears that the houses of people are looted, how do you think Imam Ali and how do you think Imam Mahdi ajallallahu farajuhu sharif today, these days, is feeling to see that his lovers and followers are killed left and right? Brutally, barbarically, mutilated. One of my friends, he is a Sayyid Rajuldeen with his family, pregnant wife and young boy. They went to a pilgrimage to Samarra, paid a visit to the holy shrines of their imams. Where in the world anyone kills the pilgrims who are on a worshipping and really worshipping God's trip? On the way back from Samarra, by these rebels, they were stopped, killed, mutilated, burned, and up until now, their bodies are not found. Really, if they were devoured in the bush by wild creatures, they would not have been treated like this. What kind of human, what is this? What can we call them? Now, the question is that, do we have any responsibility? At the time of Imam Ali alayhi salam, those rebels, they invaded Al-Anbar, now it's Al-Anbar, Mosul, Takrid, and the list goes on. During the 33-day war in Lebanon, I mentioned this khutbah, and I said that if we don't do something about it, they keep coming forward. They have already come in 8 years' time, see where have they reached. Do we have any responsibility? With salawat ala Muhammad and wa ala Muhammad, inshallah, I will share it with you. There are different attitudes towards this question. What is my duty? What is my responsibility? One attitude that I hear, unfortunately, from some members of the community is absolute denial. Everything is okay, Sheikh, don't worry. There's nothing wrong. No, we know the news. Just denial. I tell you with the motivation behind that. The second attitude towards that is that, well, I'm not Iraqi. We've got Sheikh so much to look after ourselves and our center, our organization, our community, our people back home or here. That's an Iraqi's issue. Very racist, unfortunately, an anti-Islamic comment. Third, they say, well, yes, Sheikh, but don't worry. We know the Iraqi government is taking care of it. We don't have any responsibility. We only pray for them. MashaAllah, good on you. Inshallah, you're not getting tired. When you think about it, you see that the main motivation behind such attitudes is only one. If they really go to themselves, check their conscience, they will see that there's only one main motivation behind it, and that is, don't disturb my comfort zone. Not even in my mind. Don't make me feel guilty even in my mind. Let me live my life. I've left the Middle East. I've come here to live peacefully, and I don't care about it. Subhanallah, the same people you see that when they're in the Sahara, Gade, and the socialization around the Argili, they, as Imam Ali alayhi salam says, تَقُولُونَ فِي الْمَجَالِسِ كَيْتَ وَكَيْتَ فَإِذَا جَاءَ الْقِتَالِ قُلْتُمْ حِيدِ حَيَاتِ. MashaAllah, you're so eloquent, Sheikh Mansour, when it comes to talking. But when it comes to practice, how much do we care? How much do we share? How much do we, are we running away from our responsibilities? For what? Huh? Just because you don't want your comfort zone to be touched? Is this an Islamic attitude? Subhanallah. Imam Ali alayhi salam says that those people in their falsehood, do you see that how they are united? And in your truth, you are separated. The issue today, the issue of Iraq, is not just about a bunch of homeless refugees that we need to collect some funds for them. My friend, I'm talking about such headless rebels, Mongols, I have no words for them, that once they are on a rampage, and by the way, already they have come to you in Sydney as well. Already they have come to you, if you are aware of that. Unless something seriously is done about it, globally, time will come, they come after you as well. Don't think that you are in Sydney or even in Auckland, I don't know, far away, go the farthest you can, they come after you as well. Alright, so when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us, when the Prophet are telling us that once you hear the cry of a mazloom, make sure that you are not indifferent. You see the final will of Imam Ali alayhi salam, you are not indifferent. What am I supposed to do? I'll tell you. The very first responsibility to start with at this stage, for those non-Iraqis or non-Iraqi nationals who are not living there, the very least responsibility that we have, we are at the time of jihad. You heard the fatwa of some of our eminent maraji. But the jihad for you and I at this stage at least, is that we sacrifice a portion of our wealth and share it with them, those innocent victims of these, what the rebels are doing in Al-Iraq today. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says this is the borderline, this is the time, the test that hypocrites and believers will be distinguished from one another. This is the time to know الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَهَاجَرُوا وَجَاهَدُوا فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ بِأَمْوَالِهِمْ, to start with. Now a portion of your wealth, the month of Ramadan, خُذْ مِنْ أَمْوَالِهِمْ صَدَقَةِ. Any time there was a jihad at the time of the Prophet, there was a war, all Muslims had an obligation of contributing financially something. So much so that in one of the wars, one of the poor Muslims, he goes and he comes with 3 kilos of sa'a, 3 kilos of date only. Hypocrites started blaming him. So look at his contribution. The ayah was revealed. Don't make mockery of anyone who gives anything for the sake of God. God looks at the sincerity and how much you can afford. If you make mockery, if you discourage others of doing, if you start casting doubt that, well, we don't know where this money goes. Only if it comes to me, I trust it. If it goes anywhere else, it's not trusted. What kind of attitude is this? Quran says, سَخِرَ اللَّهُ مِنْهُمْ. Make sure that God will throw back your mockery on you. وَلَهُمْ عَذَابٌ أَلِيمٌ. For such people, there will be painful torment. Inshallah, we are not going to be among them. Really, it's saddening me. It's really, sometimes I get a stomachache. How can I express myself? That I see that those rebels, you see in the news, many of them are not even Iraqis. They have the audacity to fly all over the world, from South America, from Australia, from Europe. And I really urge their governments, if they are serious, if they really care about the security of their own citizens and their own sovereign states, they have to do something about it. These are people that you begot, you created, But time will come, you'll see they will backfire on you as well. Globally, humanity has to do something about it. They have the audacity to fly all over to Iraq and kill and slain our men and women and children, and we don't have the guts to send some money to support those innocent, homeless refugees, men, women, children. What kind of Muslims are we? Imam Ali alayhi salam, I'm scared that he's talking to us as well. When he says, أَمَا دِينٌ يَجْمَعُكُمْ وَلَا حَمِيَّةَ تُحْمِشُكُمْ. Don't you have at least you Muslims, you lovers of Ahlul Bayt? Where are you? Don't you have any religion to bring you together? Don't you have any zealotry to provoke you? You hear all these news and you deny them, or you do nothing about it? وَتِلْكَ الْأَيَّامِ نداولها بين الناس وليعلم الله الذين آمنوا. These days will pass, brothers and sisters, whether you and I do anything about it or not, whether we contribute or not, in any way, form or shape. I promise you, Iraq is the land of Islam, and the land of Islam has its own leader, living, alive, even though in occultation. He will take care of it, as he has been taking care of it in the past, and other Islamic territories. But the shame may stay with you and I, may God forbid. Make sure that we pass this test. This is the time of test of faith for us, test of loyalty to our Imam. Because we've been always saying that Allahumma ajjal li waliyyika al-faraj, reading dua al-faraj. Huh? When Imam Mahdi comes, the least that you and I have to do is to give some money. In fact, he will be demanding your lives, our lives, to go for jihad. Now have a taste, small taste of it. Let's pray to God that we don't fail that test. I want to conclude, inshallah, and thank you very much for your patience. Jazakumullah for all the donation, contribution, and the unified contribution that you do to show your solidarity really with your brothers and sisters in Iraq. Inshallah, I want to conclude with a quick tawassul. At the end of the day, we need Imam al-Mahdi ajjalallahu farajahu al-Sharif to come to our aid. Assalamu alayk ya baghiyat Allah fi ardih. Assalamu alayk ayyuhal ghawthu wa rahmatul wasi'a. المستغاث بك يا صاحب الزمان يا أبا صالح المهدي. We are guilty because all what happens in our Islamic countries is because of us. يا مهدي يوسف فاطمة, we plead to you as the sinful brothers of Yusuf pleaded to their brother. يا أيها العزيز مسنا وأهلنا الضر وجئنا ببضاعة مزجاد. يا صاحب الزمان, our families, members and parts of our body in Iraq today are afflicted, wounded, and here is our little contribution. فأوف لنا الكيل وتصدق علينا إن الله يجزي المتصدقين وسيعلم الذين ظلموا أي منغلب ينغلبون. وآخر دعوانا أن الحمد لله رب العالمين. صلوات.